Let's start with kind of the basic, the most obvious question, I think, which is what is Go or Golang as it's sometimes known?
So Go or Golang is a programming language built by Google, and it's built to address the shortcomings of C++, right? So it comes with a feature set that's missing in C++, and it's also very, very fast to compile. And it has a speed that's comparable to that of C and C++. But it's also promising to be easy to read, which I'm about to show you soon. And so easy to read, in fact, that it's like Python, or that's how they're selling it. And I kind of like the word, you know, when they say that, because I really enjoy Python and the fact that it's so easy to get started with, you know, prototype, build your thing. So if something is compared to Python, you got my attention.
Yeah, I'd certainly agree with that. And the reason that I'm so wide-eyed here is like I've done C++, and by that I mean I took a semester of C++. I barely made it through it, and then just made a promise to myself never to go back and do C++ again. That I found it so confusing. And so to say, hey, this is a language that's supposed to address the shortcomings of C++, I'm thinking that complexity, but yet the syntax is similar to Python. You've certainly got my intention. I'm intrigued at how this can actually happen. How can you take C++ and make this like Python?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I think it's the fact that you're so close to the metal, right? And I mean, one of the things that C++ does for you is the whole memory management is your problem, right? So
Right.
you and me both, you and me both, we started with C++ and it was painful, and we did any other language except for C++, right? That's my first language. My second one is Java and then C Sharp, and I'm staying there, or you know, JavaScript as well. But yeah, so Go is very close to the metal, which means it's super fast to execute and makes a lot of sense to use it in like web servers or things where you really need that speed, right? So this is where Go is supposed to be used. So it's super easy to say, hey, can I use this like it's JavaScript? You can, but you know, you're probably better off using Node.js, right? But if speed is a concern, you know, go is your language for sure.
Okay, and we should make sure for anybody who's not familiar with the phrase close to the metal. So what we're talking about here is some languages like Python or like JavaScript are interpreted languages. So what's happening at runtime is there's an interpreter that's going, oh, okay, this is what we're supposed to be doing, and then it's sending those messages onto your operating system to tell it what it is that it's supposed to do. But when you're talking about, C++ or C Sharp even, which does compile down into that intermediate language, which is sort of like a step away from assembly, or with Go, that it's as close to the language that the operating system is going to speak natively as possible.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, if you compile a Go program, I think you get ones and zeros, right? You get machine code. So, you know, even there, so I think it's really great that you kind of explained that term, because I don't think it's obvious to folks when you select a language, why is this one fast and why is this one a bit slower, right? And even then, it's not the entire truth, right? Because even if you have an intermediate language, there are tricks you can do to, you know, speed it up. So in today's world, I think you're pretty good with a higher level language that's not that close to the metal, and in most cases, right?
Yeah, I agree completely. Like I always like to make this this admittedly very glib statement, which is that developers are expensive, RAM and processors are cheap, relatively speaking. And a lot of times what you're really looking for is time to market. So how fast can we develop something? And if that's what you're going for, then you can sort of overcome sort of some of the performance issues that you're going to have with like Python or JavaScript by just throwing more processors at the problem and throwing more RAM at the problem. But obviously you are going to eventually hit a point where you can only throw so many processors at it, and it's just not going to give you that performance. And so then at that point, you need to turn your attention to a language, again, like Go, like you're mentioning, or C++, something that is going to be down on the metal and going to give me that better level of performance.
Yeah, for sure.
So, how does I'm trying to figure out what question it is that I want to ask here. How do I write a Go program? I want to use that and then sort of like spin into getting into serverless here. So how do I write a Go program?
Yeah, I mean, it's you kind of start with a text file like you do in a lot of code languages, but you do need to install a runtime. If you're on a Mac, you can install it via Brew. And I believe if you're on Windows, there's some installer package. Once you're there, once you're set up and running, you just need to name that file .go, right? There's also a way to, you know, once you grow up a little bit in your knowledge, to kind of use a more project-based approach. We're not going to be that far today, but for the show, I have a very simple program. You start with that text file, you name the file ending .go, and you start typing. And as with a lot of programming languages out there, there's always this entry point, right? There's always this first function that you need to call that kind of spins up the entire app, and Go is no different. So kind of compare that to a Java program or C#, you have an entry point. You have that first main function, if you will. And it's the same thing with Go, right? You kind of start there. Start with a text file, have that entry point, and fire away.